today we're going to be making water-style miniature bases or dioramas for tabletop. Now, I say miniature, but we're making it on this huge Honorable Knight statue, which is roughly the size of a small child, so you could do that too. Wizards of the Coast came out with this new giant miniature, I guess is what they're calling it, called the Honorable Knight, or the Walking Statue. It is phenomenal, it is huge, it's like 12 inches big, and honestly, it comes with this little clear base, which I didn't know at the time when I came up with this idea. This idea originally came with the fact that I thought it didn't come with a base, so I was like, I'll make my own, I have something for that. But all that aside, we're still going to make one because that idea was stuck in my head and I thought it would be too cool not to do. So, the statue in itself comes pre-painted. It's basically just gray rock with a little bit of green vines and moss on it. And we're going to take one of those 9-inch wood round circles that I had for my pressure pot and turn it into a base. You can see it's about the right scale for the miniature compared to a normal one. And seeing that right up next to it is so funny. It's just so much smaller. I super glue both of the hands with the sword and the shield on there, and I can definitely tell that it needs a base. If not, it starts falling over on its own. Black is a really good undertone for the base instead of wood, so that if anything does show, it's just gonna look like shadow. So I have this really kind of watered down black paint. I don't know why it's this watered down, but it works for this application, that I just coat the whole thing with. You can see here I want it to stand in the middle, but I thought it would be more interesting if we did a cork board style mountain base for it to lay on. Now these cork boards you can get at IKEA for a pack of 5 for like $2, so I wanted to use them here. So I ripped one apart, and the best way to get it mountainy looking is to just rip it by hand. It'll naturally break in certain spots and it'll get this kind of craggly texture. I make 2 big pieces because I'm going for kind of a river look here and I want it to be able to flow in between. I like how it's gonna stand there. I'm gonna call that good. And I use super glue to put this down. You can try using Elmer's glue, but honestly, I don't think it's gonna hold it. And the knight has to be held down by these things where it stands too. So it's really up to you. Maybe the resin would hold it later, but I highly recommend doing the super glue. It'll give you just a tighter bond, and you won't have to worry about this moving around when you're doing all of your other parts of the build. So go ahead and coat the entire thing in super glue, and this is pretty good here. I could have left it like this, but I wanted one more piece to give it a little bit more height as I started looking at it. Now the next thing we're going to do is use the technique that I did for my other mini basing video, where we're going to take Elmer's glue and these fine stone granules. I get a huge jar of them for like $3 at Michael's, and I'll essentially never run out of it, and this will provide us with a different texture than the just cork mountainy texture. It'll give some sand and look like there's tiny little rocks and pebbles up there. So pour some glue on it, use a brush that you don't really care about to thin it out, and then pour some of the fine stone granules on it, which is basically sand. After that, you can tap on the back of it, and anything that's not touching glue will fall off. Now you've got a different texture there. Before I went too much further, I wanted to give the cork a little bit more of a roughing up. It was a little too flat for my liking, so I just took a knife and just started randomly cutting into it. The more random, the better. Humans are not random, but if we can just kind of eyeball it by not going with our instincts, we'll get something that looks pretty good. And I thought this came out pretty mountainy. I would have wanted to go further, but I stopped because I knew it was random enough. I put some more glue down, and then I go ahead and add some more sand. But with this glue, I do it all in one direction on the what will be the riverbed, because with the water flowing, all the sand can only catch as if it's coming from one direction. If it came from the other side, that wouldn't make sense. The water would swipe it away. So you can see everywhere I put glue here is as if the river was pushing sand from one side. There's nothing on the other ones. Now this is one of the more important steps, and it's entirely optional, but I think it really adds a lot of variety. If you just have the mountainy texture, that doesn't make sense. How did it get all of those holes in it without having some rocks that kind of stand on their own? You don't just see mountainous rock if you go climb around in the hills or go hiking. You see rocks everywhere, so you want to have different sizes. I put rocks all over, both on the top and in the riverbed here, and the riverbed ones are really important because when the resin dries, it's going to be clear and you're going to see on the inside. So having some textural difference inside there really is important. Now, everything looks completely different, and that's fine. We're going to paint them all individually here in a bit. So let's go ahead and coat this thing up in black paint yet again. You might be able to use spray paint, but I wanted to just use this paint because it's super cheap, and I can make sure that I get it in every single nook and cranny. It's really important, especially with the black, that you hit all of the edges here. That way, if you miss anything, you see black and not brown. That being said, you'll still see some brown right here. Now we're gonna take a really dark gray and coat the same way we did the black. The black is a nice undertone. It'll help us if we miss any spots, but this dark gray is gonna be the basis color that we're gonna use moving forward. You can see here, that's not very appealing just looking at it like that. So we have to do what's called dry brushing. And I like to use a kind of brownish cream because rocks aren't all just gray and black, right? They are a cream color. And dry brushing is where you just take paint off of your brush and use what little paint there is on the brush to hit the edges of everything. You can see here, it immediately transforms this from a gray blobby mess to stone. As you're taking the brush and running it along the edges, it's only able to hit the highlights. And this is a fantastic way to paint fur or rocks like this to get something really, really natural looking. Again, this cream really kind of brings it out. You can see here how good this immediately looks versus this gray blob. That you wouldn't even be able to tell is stone. The other one looks fantastic. So I go ahead and brush the rest over with this cream, and then I do a second color to get some variety with gray. And this one I'm gonna just go right over the top and do a much lighter dry brushing compared to the cream that I did. Now it's time to use a wash, and a wash is just really thin paint that will get into the cracks and crevices. I'm gonna get a lot of flack here for using a Citadel wash on something this large instead of making my own, but honestly, I can't get this same color on my own. I've tried and I just can't match it. Now you totally can try. It's just gonna take some brown paint, some water, and then a tiny dab of dish soap, and you'll get something close, but it's not exactly what I wanted. So for this project, I was willing to splurge. After I do the brown, you're gonna get this weird kind of earthy color. You can leave it like that, but I go over it one more time with the dry brush so that it really get that mountainy gray rock slate that I'm looking for. You're fine to leave it without doing the wash. You're fine to do it right after the wash. This is entirely your project. You pick how you want to do it. Now I'm using a Bob Ross Thalo Blue here. The package makes it look purple, but it comes out blue, I swear. And I mix it with a little bit of black paint and water so that it's thinned down. This is going to be the deep part of the river. I use this and coat the entirety of the bottom, making sure to try and get right up under the edges without coloring the rocks themselves. This is what you are going to see through the resin, and it's going to make the water look blue. I avoid the areas that have that kind of textured rock because that's supposed to look like sandy gravel, and there's not going to be much blue under that. I make a little bit lighter of one by mixing that phthalo blue with some of the blackish blue that I did before and go over the higher parts of the water, and then I just kind of take the brush over some other parts too to give some textural differences. Now, if I want to put resin in here, it's going to flow right out, and that's a problem. But we can fix that with some Scotch tape. Now, I learned this Scotch tape technique from Red Beard Baron on YouTube. Totally go check him out because the Scotch tape little resin guard was not my idea, it's his. So he deserves the credit for this one, and it worked phenomenally by the end. So I completely wrapped the whole thing in Scotch tape. There's no good way to film transparent Scotch tape, so I don't really show that one there, but just wrap it as much as you can, wrap some under it, and then take some hot glue and run it along the underside of where your Scotch tape ends. This will be a second barrier so that resin really can't sneak out. And honestly, I was glad I did this because I found some areas where resin did try to sneak out by the very end of it. So I definitely recommend doing both the Scotch tape and the hot glue at the end. Now we're gonna take some Art and Glow resin. I like using this resin because it's really cheap and I can get it in large volumes for the water effects. And when we use resin, it's gonna be a really hard, strong, and durable water effect, which is something that I like. Now this is a two-part resin. You mix equal parts A and part B, and I'm also using this green and blue food dye. Now, water-based food dye can mess with your resin, so be aware. Only use a few drops. I used one of green and two of blue and got this kind of chlorine water. That's not what I'm looking for. So I added two more green and one more blue, so three of each, and it gave me this kind of river watercolor. And here's the money shot. This is gonna be on the oddly satisfying videos. I can see it in a month. pour of the resin over this. And as the resin is pouring, you can see that it has that nice blue undertone, as well as you're able to see all of the cracks in the rocks. And I take a pipette and fill up any areas that I'm not confident in my pouring abilities for not getting it on the top. After about 24 hours, you can see here, it's nice and hard. I'm able to take the hot glue off the side and start working on the rest of it, as well as taking the tape off. Now, the tape will leave this kind of weird grainy film on the side. I like it. It distinguishes where the base actually is on the top. If you don't like it, all you got to do is put some wipe-on varnish on the side and it'll be just as clear as the top. It's just personal preference. Now, the top of the water is far too stale. If you want to just kind of a puddle, this is great, but I want mine to be looking like it's moving. So I take this glossy Mod Podge, and when it dries, it's going to be just as clear as this resin is. You just can't get it to dry in huge amounts. So I just completely load this whole thing up with this glossy Mod Podge. It'll make it look like a moving river, and sometimes I kind of make rows out of it to make it look like the river has flowed into this wave of sorts, and this works really well for ocean type setups as well. So now I've got my waves. I want to get some bubbles in there where it looks like the water is hitting the sides and causing air to form bubbles, as water does. But you want to make sure you only hit it on the sides where water is flowing. So again, this is the side where water is flowing into. So I take some of that glossy gesso that you saw and mix it with a tiny, tiny bit of white paint, enough to where it's still see-through, but you get that white effect. And I go ahead and cover pretty much anywhere that water is going to hit directly head-on and possibly leave bubbles. I take another set of that gesso with more gesso and less white to give some depth behind the little wave versions there. And while that's drying, because we can knock out two birds with one stone here, I'm going to go ahead and put the statue on. And with that, I try not to make it any more complicated than it needs to be. I put a huge bunch of super glue on it with some confidence. I set him down and I hold it up for about 10 minutes, enough to where it'll stand on its own, and then I leave it overnight. The final touch to this is using some static grass. Now, you could use a static grass applicator. I don't have one. I'm going to use these little grass tufts. I don't trust the glue that comes on the back of them. I don't think it's very strong, so I put another dab of super glue on it. This whole thing is almost made out of super glue, and take the grass tufts and put it on there. This is the wasteland one, so it really looks like it's barely growing in this rocky area. And guess what? Voila! We have ourselves a completed miniature, quote, base and diorama. This is my first attempt at a diorama, period, and I'm honestly very, very proud. This came out far better than I really could have hoped for. I thought about putting trees on there, but it would really distract from how good the water came out on this. I'm just super pleased. I didn't think that I could make anything look as good as this does, and I know that there's things that could change to make it look better, but I'm damn proud of this. I think it looks really, really good. And so I'm planning to do this on some mini miniatures in the future, but this guy will be a terror when I bring him out on the table. I mean, just look at how imposing he is. With that, thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate it. Maybe let me know in the comments down below what other builds you might want to see me make, or some other dice. I definitely have added all your suggestions to my to-do list. I'll just have to get them in the order that I can. I have some more giveaways coming up, so please subscribe if you might want to see some more, or check out some of my other videos, or share this with other people. That helps me out because I'm trying to turn this into a full thing that I can do. So thank you for watching. I hope you have a fantastic day, and I appreciate your time.